Our Sunday church service is called Sola Publishing, and they provide the lectionary selections so that they're all pre-printed and arranged for us, and they also provide suggested prayers for us, and they're the ones that I typically use on Sunday mornings when we come to the point where we do the prayers of the church. Every once in a while I read a prayer, and I wonder what the author might have had in mind when he wrote it, and sometimes I wonder whether or not he ever took an English class. So I was in that dilemma this morning, and I had to rewrite something because it was just kind of dumb. So forgive my tardiness. We do have a few announcements in my wife's handwriting. I'm wearing new glasses. I just got these this week. And of course, the prescription is adjusted so that I have to play in a little trombone here now. So, and I'm reading in my wife's handwriting here. Been married to the woman 137 years, but I still have trouble with her penmanship. Women's Bible Study will meet this Thursday, February 8th at 6:30 p.m. at the Parsonage. And you'll be making Valentine's cards for the healthcare center. That seems nice. Please join us for fun, fellowship, a servant project, and treats. You come to the Parsonage and there's always something freshly baked. If you have questions, contact Cindy. My wife is actually up in the loft today running the PowerPoint, and she has the Leskie's little boy on her lap, so he's not in the lap. I thought we were going to blame him if buttons got pushed and the screens were wrong. Well, okay, I guess we're not going to blame him for button pushing. What else have we got here? Worship and Evangelism Committee meeting will be today following the service. Were there any other announcements or anything that anybody wanted to offer? Seeing no hands raised, then I guess we will begin with our opening hymn, Won't You Please Rise? Praise to the Lord the Almighty, from the Lutheran Book of Worship, 543. I'm going to get my other glasses for this too. These are kind of a computer glasses, my doctor called them when he made them. It's a composite of my bifocals. And it seems to be good for arm's length kind of thing. Yeah, they're perfect. We'll go with this. And so let us begin in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. From the first letter of John, we read that if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves. The truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is merciful and just, will forgive us of all of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And so now, in a moment of silence, I invite you to offer to God what burdens your heart this morning. And so we confess. Most merciful God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all of our sins. And so now, as a member with you in the priesthood of all believers, but by the authority of Jesus Christ our Lord, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Pray with me now our prayer of the day. Stand watch over your family, O Lord, that we who depend entirely on your heavenly grace may always be protected in the mighty fortress of your love. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Won't you be seated, and we will have our readings.
Good morning. Good morning. The first reading comes from Isaiah chapter 40, verses 21 through 31. Do you not know? Do you not hear? Has it not been told you from the beginning? Have you not understood from the foundations of the earth? It is he who sits above the circle of the earth, and its inhabitants are like grasshoppers, who stretches out the heavens like a curtain and spreads them like a tent to dwell in, who brings princes to nothing and makes the rulers of the earth as emptiness. Scarcely are they planted, scarcely sown, scarcely has their stem taken root in the earth, when he blows on them and they wither, and the tempest carries them off like stubble. To whom then will you compare me, that I should be like him? Says the Holy One. Lift up your eyes on high and see, who created these? He who brings out their host by number, calling them all by name, by the greatness of his might, and because he is strong in power, not one who is missing. Why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel? My way is hidden from the Lord, and my right is disregarded by my God. Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint, and to him who has no might, he increases strength. Even youths shall faint and be weary, and young men shall fall exhausted. But they who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. The word of the Lord. The second reading comes from 1 Corinthians chapter 9. Verses 16 through 27. For if I preach the gospel, that gives me no ground for boasting, for necessity is laid upon me. Woe to me if I do not preach the gospel. For if I do this of my own will, I have a reward, but if not of my own will, I am still entrusted with a stewardship. When, then, is my reward? That in my preaching I may present the gospel free of charge, so as not to make full use of my right in the gospel? For though I am free from all, I have made myself a servant to all, that I might win more of them. To the Jews I become as a Jew, in order to win Jews. To those under the law I became as one, under the law, though not being myself under the law, that I might win those under the law. To those outside the law I became as one outside the law, not being outside the law of God, but under the law of Christ, that I might win those outside the law. To the weak I become weak, I became weak, that I might win the weak. I have become all things to all people, that by all means I might save some. I do it all for the sake of the gospel, that I might share with them in its blessings. Do you not know that in a race all the runners run, but only one receives the prize? So run that you may obtain it. Every single athlete exercises self-control in all things. They do it to receive perishable wreath, but we an imperishable. So I do not run aimlessly. I do not box as one beating the air, but I discipline my body and keep it under control, lest after preaching to others, I myself should be disqualified. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Karen, won't you please rise then for a reading of our holy gospel. Today we read, once again, from the Gospel of Mark, from the first chapter. Immediately, Jesus left the synagogue and entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. Now Simon's mother-in-law lay ill with a fever, and immediately they told him about her. And he came and took her by the hand and lifted her up. And the fever left her, and she began to serve them. That evening at sundown, they brought to him all who were sick or oppressed by demons, and the whole city was gathered together at the door. And he healed many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many demons. And he would not permit the demons to speak because they knew him. And rising very early in the morning, while it was still dark, he departed and went out to a desolate place, and there he prayed. And Simon and those who were with him searched for him, and they found him. And they said to him, "Everyone is looking for you." And he said to them, "Let us go on to the next towns, that I may preach there also, for that is why I came out." And he went throughout all Galilee, preaching in their synagogues and casting out demons. The Gospel of the Lord. Won't you be seated? Grace and peace to you from God our Heavenly Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, to a great extent, our gospel reading for today is the continuation, the conclusion, to the vignette we began last week. You will recall that I told you that this is Mark's beginning of the actual ministry story of Jesus. And so all of these verses, last week's and today's, show us about a 24-hour visit in Capernaum. Capernaum was Jesus's base of operations, we might say, for his ministry in Galilee. And he will return to Capernaum many times and will perform further miracles there. And Matthew and Mark and Luke and John will tell of these. You might also recall from last week that I told you this opening of Mark's was written in proclamation that this Jesus is the chosen one, the promised Messiah, And last week, I will continue today to try to give you a sense of Mark's earnestness and his urgency for impressing this point upon us. And this week, it happens that I get a lot of help from the book of Isaiah. Carrie Ann read for us very well, but I want to amplify a few of those verses. Do you not know? Do you not hear? Has it not been told you from the beginning? Have you not understood from the foundations of the earth? It is He who sits above the circle of the earth, and its inhabitants are like grasshoppers. He who stretches out the heavens like a curtain and spreads them like a tent to dwell in. Who brings princes to nothing and makes the rulers of the earth as emptiness. Scarcely are they planted, scarcely sown, scarcely has their stem taken root in the earth when he blows on them and they wither and the tempest carries them off like stubble. Lift up your eyes on high and see. Who created these? He who brings out their host by number, calling them all by name, by the greatness of his might, and because he is strong in power. Not one is missing. Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. He gives power to the faint, and to him who has no might, he increases strength. Indeed, they who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not be faint. Well, I hope I've done justice to Isaiah in this passage. He's very worked up, but not for nothing. You know, sometimes I suppose we think these prophets are a bunch of angry, shouting guys. They can get whipped up at the drop of a hat, it seems. And yeah, you know, I admit that I can hear that too when I read them. Haggai and Zephaniah, oh, they crack their whips plenty. Habakkuk, Nahum, Micah, Amos all spend plenty of time on their high horses. Well, to be fair to them, the Almighty gave them all very important things to say, and they were mostly trying to say them to a stiff-necked people who didn't want to hear it. Well, I mean, they'd heard it all before. Yada, yada, yada. They got it. They got the picture. But today Isaiah is speaking to the children of Israel who had been devastated by the armies of Babylon. All of Israel's best and brightest young had been carried off to Assyrian cities, mostly along the Euphrates River in what is today northern Iraq. But left behind was all of a Judah utterly plundered, and the temple in Jerusalem destroyed. Well, now I think you might agree that those last two sentences sound bad enough, but in Judah, all of that destruction of prosperity and all of that removal of ordered society left a sort of a vacuum as Babylon's armies marched back to the north. And you know how it is with vacuums in politics. It was quickly filled, but by Israel's pagan enemies. More pillaging, more rape and destruction. And then even worse, in a land that once worshipped the God of Abraham and his commandments given to Moses, these shattered people now looked out upon a land infested with the weeds of vile rituals praising false gods. It was little better for the exiles along the Euphrates. Now, while their captivity was more of a, you could call it a house arrest, they were given some opportunity to work, and they could, to some extent, prosper themselves, and they were allowed to trade in the markets. But they were nevertheless surrounded by people worshiping the Babylonian gods. Babylonian policy was to overwhelm them with Babylonian culture and wipe out the culture and religion of their homeland. So all of them, exiles and those left behind, began to believe they'd been abandoned by an inferior god. A god who had once promised them much, but who now had been defeated. Well, their homes stripped from them by destruction or deportation. Now they were losing their faith and indeed losing their very identity. Now, for some 50 years or so, the children of Abraham existed in Babylonian tyranny, but then something happened. God raised up a servant. Highly unexpected, he raised up a servant from outside. A foreign man who would be king. His name was Cyrus, and he was a Persian. Through God, Cyrus was able to draw kingdoms together in an alliance eventually strong enough to bring powerful Babylon to its knees. But Cyrus was not a king set upon domination of peoples like the Babylonians were. He did not desire to obliterate societies and cultures. To the contrary, he wanted to help the exiles to return to their promised land and help the left behinds to regain and restore order in Judah. And he would also, in time, send aid to rebuild the temple in Jerusalem, but I'm getting a little ahead of my story. Well, so now, into the void created by a toppled Babylon, a voice. One crying in this new wilderness would speak hope and restoration, would remind the people of their identity, and recall to them their God, who had not abandoned them, but who had remained steadfast all along. His wrath had brought the Babylonian Holocaust upon them, but now he would restore, heal, and prosper them anew. Do you not know? Do you not hear? Has it not been told you from the beginning? The prophet Isaiah is giving them motivation, announcing God's plan, God's will, God's love. And so again, about 500 years later, Mark announces to Israel once again the plan, the will, and the love of God. Arrived as foretold and delivering them as promised. But Mark is careful, just as Isaiah was. Now, we heard today but a short section from one chapter of Isaiah's proclamation, and he will have much more to say to these Babylonian exiles. These children of God returning. For 15 chapters, Isaiah will proclaim to them a full and complete picture of God's power and glory and plan. This was not a God returning, not a God who had been knocked down but had crawled up from the floor and rejoined the battle, had snatched a victory from the jaws of the feet. No, this was the God of all creation and of all eternity. And all that has been and all that will be is of his design, his intention, his will. Have you not understood from the foundations of the earth? Lift up your eyes on high and see. Mark begins his proclamation with our lesson verses from this first chapter, and he too will unfold his complete story in another 15 chapters. And he begins by showing us a picture of the Christ. See the healer of all illness and afflictions, but don't stop there. See the great teacher of power and authority, but don't stop there. See the deliverer who is greater than all evils, but don't stop there. In this story of healings, secrecy and devotion to mission, do not just hear what you've heard before, but receive an invitation to begin to experience the Messiah, unique in his identity. Here is God. Here is your hope. Here is your salvation. The one who came to be your all in all is greater than what all earthly words or pictures or songs could tell. Don't stop there. His words, his deeds, his death, and his resurrection are God's plan, God's will, God's everlasting love for you. Thanks be to God. Amen. Well, we have a hymn of the day. I love to tell the story. Well, I certainly do. Oh, that's the title of the song. Number 390. And let's stand and sing this. I love to tell the story.
Thank you.
long as I got you, and I'm going to need my other glasses now to see at a distance. A lot of work, this new prescription stuff, I guess. I'm going to have to work on that, I guess. I didn't expect this. New glasses, they should be perfect. And so we proclaim together our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. And so we declare, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you all. Let's share with one another a sign of that peace. Good morning once again. God's peace.
Peace be with you. 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 Peace be with you.
We'll begin our offering. Well, we'll pray together then our opening or our offering prayer. And we pray, Lord, we thank you for the many gifts you have given us. Teach us to use them in charity and compassion. In stewardship and service to others, through your Holy Spirit, give us awareness of your mercies, that with truly thankful hearts, we may praise you on our lips and in our lives, that we may give ourselves to your service, that we may walk in your ways holy, and by the righteousness of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. And so now let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all according to their needs. Tender Lord of mercy, you know our deepest thoughts and fears that can draw our hearts and minds away from our faith and prayerful time spent with you. Help us to remember that you alone can sustain us through whatever we face in our lives. Help us remember that in time of trial, you have not abandoned us. Teach us to trust in you and to hold fast to your promised love. Make us, your church, a beacon of such hope to the world in its many concerns. Lord, in your mercy. Gracious Father, we don't always seek you first in times of gratitude or trouble or for counsel. We ask today that we would be ever mindful that you are always there for us. We also pray for those who don't know you. May we be a light of hope to them through our prayers, our words, and our deeds. We ask that you would pour out your Holy Spirit upon us so that we may know that we are to pray at all times and in all situations. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, we know that there are countless people who live among us that feel lonely or uncared for. We pray as your church that we would intentionally work to find them through our ministries. Let us be your hands and feet in the world to serve others as you would have us do. Lord, in your mercy. Father God, we pray for those who are sick, who are hospitalized, who are preparing for surgeries or suffering in any way. Today especially, we pray for Dee Dee and Ricky, for Kurt and Marilyn and Tom and Don, Ken and John, Roger and Ardell, and those in care centers like Phyllis and Bob, Zelda, Marianne, Doris, Wes, Ruth, and Mabel. And Lord, for those we now each of us name in our lips, on our lips or in our hearts. We pray that they would be consoled and strengthened to endure through their faith in Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Lord, in your mercy. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your heart. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to Almighty God. Amen. It was on the very night in which he was betrayed when our Lord took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take all of you and eat, for this is my body, given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again after supper, he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take all of you and drink. "For this is my blood, a new covenant, shed for you and for many, for the forgiveness of your sins. Do this as often as you drink it, for the remembrance of me." Let us pray together now the words our Savior taught us. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. All is ready at the table of the Lord, and all who call upon the name of Jesus Christ are welcome here. We'll commune the help, and then the ushers will direct you in a moment. You may be seated. Now may this body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen and preserve you unto life everlasting. Send us forth from this table, Lord, as witnesses to the resurrection, that all may know life in Jesus' name. Amen. Will you rise, please, for the benediction? May the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you his peace. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Closing hymn from the Blue Book, On Eagle's Wings. Go in peace and serve the risen Lord.